Today on The Educated Pour, we will be discussing gin. So drink smart, drink well, and cheers.
Oh, let's get drunk. Give me a cup of gin. Oh, let's get drunk. Alcohol, my only friend. Look at my lips, cause I got the craving. Saturday night, and I've been saving my appetite for alcohol. Keep on giving all my peeps a call. Where can we do this? It really don't matter. Let's get drunk. No, let's get plastered. I ain't got stuff to do in the morning. Let's
get drunk. Gin. Do you know it from the martinis of James Bond? And as a stalwart favorite of the cocktail culture when mixed with tonic and a splash of lime. But what is the story behind this liquor hero so often teamed up with a mixer sidekick, so to speak? What is this liquor like behind the mixer mask? Gin is a white spirit, derived primarily from wheat or rye, which gives it a light-bodied taste. Gin is flavored with juniper berries and a concoction of various botanicals. Botanicals themselves are herbs such as anise, angelica root, cinnamon, orange peel, and coriander, the combinations of which will vary depending on the brand of gin you prefer. Each brand has its own secret recipe. Gin comes in three classifications: London Dry, Plymouth Gin, and Old Tom Gin.
Unlike beer, I do often drink liquor, and when I do, I enjoy gin.
Because it goes well with Dos Equis. Say it.
Because it goes well with Dos Equis.
You know, that doesn't even really make sense.
Let's take that again until I get it. Shut up.
The origins of gin are shrouded in a certain mistiness, but evidence points to the Netherlands as its country of origin.
Hola, inglés. Usted morirá.
Morirá.
Not so fast, Dago. For the Dutch!
Later on, gin, or Jennifer as it is known in Holland and Belgium, found its way across the English Channel as a medicinal spirit meant to act as a diuretic, which I looked up. Inevitably, as behavior-modifying substances are wont to do, gin made its way out of the British medicine cabinet and into the public house. See histories of cocaine and opium, respectively. By 1720, after a certain British royal abolished taxes on the production of local spirits, including gin, it was estimated that one quarter of London households were used for the brewing of bathtub gin. In addition, people in the 18th and 19th centuries were taken to dumping their waste in the streets, subsequently tainting local water sources. So what did the people drink? You guessed it, gin. Mass drunkenness ensued, which is why the Dutch still wear wooden shoes to this day. I'm sorry? I'm sorry. I am being told that last part is not true. I apologize. Over time, England helped develop gin into its most popular style, and with the expansion of the English Empire in the 1800s, English-style gin followed British troops wherever on the globe they landed.
Hey, you know what would make this taste better? What? Booze?
In the US, gin production came to the colonies with the British. Almost 140 years after the US declared independence, Prohibition helped gin become a favorite bathtub brew, since unlike other liquors, it didn't require any aging. Whether in the bathtub or behind the bar, gin is a pioneer spirit of the first order, and is sure to remain one of the world's most popular liquors.
Of all the gin joints in all the towns in all the world, she walks into mine.
Today on The Educated Pour, we will be testing gin. The two brands of gin we have here are Tanqueray and Hendrick's. Tanqueray is a London dry gin bottled in Great Britain, and Hendrick's is a dry gin bottled in Scotland. First thing we're going to do is pour some Tanqueray. The first thing you'll notice about gin, if you're new to gin, is its odor. It has a smell that reminds you of Christmas trees. That's because the primary flavoring in gin is the juniper berry, which comes from an evergreen tree. Tanqueray is a good example of a London dry gin. You can taste the juniper berries very strongly, and there are also hints of anise, coriander, and various other spices that add a subtle quality to it. Next, we'll be tasting Hendrick's, which, as I said, is a bit more unique. In addition to the usual juniper berries and various spices that you'll find in any dry gin, Hendrick's also uses rose petals and cucumber, which add a subtle aftertaste. In addition, you'll find that Hendrick's is much smoother, at least in my opinion, than an ordinary gin. If you're not used to drinking gin, the difference between Tanqueray and Hendrick's is subtle, and you probably wouldn't notice. However, if you are a gin drinker, and you tend to drink gin straight, usually an extra dry martini, then you will notice these subtle differences. Right now we'll be making a gin and tonic, one of the most popular drinks involving gin. As the name suggests, you will need gin, tonic water, ice, and a lime for garnish if you so desire. Tonic water has its origins in India, where soldiers had to drink quinine water in order to ward off malaria. Now, in making any mixed drink, you always start off with the liquor. I personally prefer gin and tonic at a 1-to-1 ratio, 50% gin, 50% tonic. The herbs and spices of the gin carefully offset the bitterness of the quinine water for a very refreshing taste. Then all you have to do is add a lime. Cheers. Another popular drink made with gin is the gin martini. Here's a tip. While you're making the martini, chill the glass. You can do that very simply by adding ice and water. You'll leave the ice and water to chill the glass while you're mixing the ingredients, and then when you're done, dispose of the water and ice and pour. Your guests will appreciate it. Alright, so let's make the martini. I have here my shaker, already filled with ice. And you're going to pour about 6 counts of gin. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Followed by another count of dry vermouth. Then you'll add the top and use the shaker as advertised. When you're done shaking, get rid of the water and ice. And as you can see, you have a nice chilled glass in which to pour the finished product. Garnish with an olive if you'd like, or just enjoy as is. There are various different ways to make a martini, and each person has their own preferences. Winston Churchill was said to pour the gin, shake, glance at a vermouth bottle, and then pour into his glass, and he would never reuse the bottle of vermouth. You may be wondering what to do if you don't have a shaker. That's easy. All you have to do is prepare the drink ordinarily and then find a second glass, or in this case I'll use the bottom of my shaker, that creates a seal. Shake, and you have a nicely strained drink. Historically, gin was believed to bruise when it was shaken, and so a martini was supposed to be prepared only when stirred. This gave rise to the popular quote, shaken, not stirred.
Okay, I love you're good. My you're whiskey, and I love my gin. Every time you see me, I'm in my sin. So what's the use of getting sober when you gotta get drunk again?
I went out.
Hey, John.
Yeah?
You know what would make this blog better?
Booze. In a can!
Stay thirsty, my friends.